Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Grace Fellowship Church this morning. As you guys are come on in from the lobby, come on in, find your seats. We are going to be having a wonderful service celebrating God's work and God's love in other countries today. And it's our missionary conference today, our missions conference. And I got to tell you, missions people are some of the most special people on the planet. God uses them in and out and throughout their lives. And we're just so thankful to be hosting them today. I'm going to invite you to stand, and we're going to sing about God's love this morning, because it needs to go out to all generations, all countries, all creeds. And this is what we're going to talk about today.
All you're thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. His one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in Him will live forever. Foot of the cross, Jesus is waiting there with open arms. For God so loved the world that He gave us His one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in Him will live forever. Defeated, now it is well. I'm walking in freedom, for God so loved, God so loved the world. We praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, for the wonders of His love. For the wonders of His love. We praise God, from whom all blessings flow. We praise Him, for the wonders of His love. is one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in Him will live forever, ever. The power of hell forever defeated. Failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world.
All God's people said, amen. I'm going to invite David and Jane Borg to come on up, and please have a seat.
Good morning, everyone. Revelation 7, 9 through 12 states that, behold, a great multitude which no one could count from every nation and all tribes and peoples and tongues standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They cried out with a loud voice saying, salvation to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. USA,
Malawi,
Afghanistan,
Uganda,
Argentina,
Guatemala,
Mexico,
India,
Serbia,
the Navajo Nation,
Ghana,
Papua New Guinea,
Kenya,
Ukraine,
Thailand,
Haiti,
Bolivia,
Philippines, and Greece.
Welcome to the annual Grace Fellowship Missions Conference.
This year's Missions Conference theme is Give That Others May Live. The verse is 1 Timothy 6:18. Let them do good that they be rich in good works, ready to give, willing to share.
Thank you, guys. That's great. You've seen all these flags waving. You are free to put those in our stands. We can display them for the remainder of our service in the next couple of weeks. To do that, I am. My name is Mark. If you're visiting today, I'm the lead pastor here at Grace Fellowship. Grateful to be a part of a community of faith who gives such precedence to missions. I feel like we are the wealthy ones in the United States, where we have so much access to information and certainly the gospel. God has blessed us right where we're at, and we have become historically a sending agency as a nation, but specifically as a church. We prioritize the gospel of Jesus Christ going all over the world. And from our inception as a local church here, Grace Fellowship, we endeavored to give 10% of every dollar that comes in through any offering of our general offerings that come in from Sunday to Sunday, right off the top, 10% of everything that comes in, we send right back out to the mission field. We recognize our privileged position, and we want to leverage the wealth that God has given us as just people with the information and the salvation that we've received to make sure that that good news message goes out all over the world. And so over time, as our church, Grace Fellowship, began, we began small like any church does in a house, and it begins to grow and expand to the point that we are now, that we have so many resources that we're continuing to contribute. That 10% has grown, as has the number of missionaries that we support. So when you see all of these flags that are represented, they represent missionaries or missions around the world that we are either currently involved with or have been through the course of our history as Grace Fellowship. And so we're excited. Every year since the very first year of that Grace Fellowship has existed, we have hosted a missions conference. Often it's been over the course of one weekend where we jam in all kinds of stuff over the course of the weekend, but we've expanded that in the last couple of years to do it over a couple of weekends so we can really highlight and maximize the time we give to this important part of why we exist. So I want to draw attention before I invite our first missionary guest to come on up here to the display tables that you may have seen when you first came in this morning, but I want to invite you to visit them along the back wall. And there's some display tables over here I'm going to describe a little bit later on this morning. But on many of our missionaries that we support that you can be actively involved with have information and pictures, and many of them are here representing those ministries this morning. And before and after service, today, next Sunday, and even the following week after that, these tables are going to be up so you can really understand what's going on and how we're connected to these various missions. So if you don't get to all of them today, that's okay. They're going to be here next week. If you don't get to them next week, you can be the following week. So it's really take a moment to linger at these tables. Engage in conversation with those who are there representing those ministries. And one more table I want to draw attention to is in our hallway. Now, when you first come in to our front doors in the lobby, and you oftentimes will go either left to drop our kids off, either the children's ministry or that important place in our building called the restroom. We walk down the hall, and you'll see on your left are pictures of all of the missionaries that we are currently engaged with all around the world and their ministries. And on that, so I want to direct your attention to that hallway, the wall there, but also there's a table out there that's been set up for you there's little note cards and envelopes and a basket there. What we're going to do is go out there, and if you look at those pictures and see who we're engaged with, take time to write a little note of encouragement. Hey, this is how I'm praying for you. This is, you know, how you're in my thoughts today. Or maybe if you think about a scripture verse that God might put in your heart, or one that's been encouraging to you, want to include that as a part of your message of encouragement. Put that in an envelope, put it in that little basket at that table, and that information is going to be sent to make sure that each of our missionaries get that so they can feel connected and encouraged. Again, that table is going to be up for the next Sunday and the Sunday following that. So take some time. Don't be in a rush. Just enjoy these wonderful resources we have both to invest in, as well as we ourselves get great encouragement from. So today we have some featured missionaries and missions that we are a part of at Grace Fellowship. We have since 2010 have had a direct connection with Haiti. You'll remember that in 2010, there was that great earthquake that really devastated, created a great death toll in Haiti. And we, through that, got boots on the ground there in country, and we started to make connections with people. And out of that expanded a wonderful connection to ministries that are ongoing that we feel like we can be directly influencing, getting supplies and resources, and most importantly, the gospel of Jesus to specific people that we can meet, that we can talk to, and get reports back from. This morning, we get to hear directly from those ministries, how they're going, and so on. And so here to do that, you're gonna see Claudel here, who is our main liaison between us and the school that we sponsor in Carrefour, as well as Wendy and Jeremy Chadwick, who are members of Grace for lots of years. Their kids grew up here at Grace, and I think all of them have been to Haiti. Caleb, have you been to Haiti? Yes, all of them have been to Haiti and have served and so on. They're really hands-on as a family with regard to their heart to serve in this part of the world, and you're gonna hear that through them as they share. So if you would, help me welcome Wendy and Jeremy Chadwick. Come on up.
Good morning. It's great to see you all here this morning. This is such an awesome weekend that we do every year for the Missions Weekend. I just think about the fact that these missions are God's missions, and we have the privilege to partner with our Creator God to spread this message of salvation that He has for the world, and we get to have that privilege. And I hope that we can all see it that way. That we get to partner with God in these missions. These are not our missions. These are God's missions. And this is what we get to partner in to do that. As Pastor Mark mentioned, after the earthquake in 2010, I believe God spoke to a couple hearts in this church, a few of them actually, but one of which was our founding pastor, Pastor Dale Barrett. Watching these scenes unfold on the screen, God stirred in his heart, as well as my wife's heart and our oldest son, Jason, to take action. And so from Pastor Dale's perspective, that led to them planning a trip in which they went down to Haiti. Him and two others from the church went down, and through God's divine intervention, he connected them with Pastor Gilbert Jules in Haiti. And through that relationship, it has spawned a bunch of different activities that we have had in Haiti. One of which, one of the big things is Gilbert, when Pastor Dale has put it that it's like when he went down there was so much need, it felt like trying to drain the ocean one dropper full at a time is what he said multiple times. It just seemed overwhelming. How can I help? And so Gilbert's heart was, this country needs to know God. This country needs the gospel, and he wanted to train up pastors and church leaders to go out and share the gospel. And so that's how it started. So pastor training has been one way initially that we as a church have helped send teams down there. I've had the privilege of going with Pastor Dale to teach. Pastor Mark has been on one of those trips to go and teach. And so training these pastors and church leaders is giving them tools to go out and to their own people and continue to spread the word of God. The other is we have gone and done building projects there. Some of those, I've been on one. We went at a time of year that was, I told Mike, if you ever go again on a building project, please go in January, not in May. it was rough, but we had the privilege of being able to put the roof on the church there So the, at the school they're going to hear about that we help sponsor kids at, there's a church adjacent. We put a roof on that church. We've also put a roof on the school for the first level of the school. It just had walls, had no roof. They had it tarped, so when it was pouring rain, they couldn't have school. So we've sent a group down there. And as well as there was a project, too, a few of you have been on to help put a second level onto Pastor Gilbert's home. And the significance of his home is that he opens up for missionaries who come to Haiti. They were staying at, he would host them at his home. So those are just some of the building projects that we've done. The other is we've done a couple VBS programs for the kids there. There are a lot of kids, and so we've had some trips where some VBS sessions have been held. And then also there's evangelism and church planting. That's one of Gilbert's hearts right now. Probably need to put the volume down on that. Thank you. That is actually what Gilbert is doing actively right now. So right now, Pastor Gilbert is in the town of Jeremy in Haiti. If you look, you can look on a map, it's to due west of pretty much Port-au-Prince. And I've had the privilege of visiting there. But he's there right now doing evangelism training and reaching the people there in that town. His wife, she's a doctor in Haiti, and she does health clinics. So some of our support has gone to help support these health clinics that she uses as an outreach. And then also we've done some emergency relief. So I mentioned the town of Jeremy. There was a trip that we had planned after Hurricane Matthew. We didn't know that Hurricane Matthew was coming. By the time, so when we planned this trip, the hurricane hit like a month or two before we were supposed to go, and it totally changed our trip. So Pastor Dale at the time decided we took a large sum of money down there, and we sat with pastors for half a day and just hearing the devastation, the stories of the devastation to their churches from the hurricane as well as to people's homes. And so we sat and we handed out envelopes of money to help them to rebuild. And one of the places we went to visit and offer encouragement is the town of Jeremy. And then lastly, kind of what we want to highlight this morning and that many of you have, are helped and involved in is through this child sponsorship program, The Bridge, that we was a part of what how the Lord spoke to my wife, Wendy, and led to this child sponsorship program to benefit a school in Carrefour, Haiti. But at this time, I want to turn it over to her so that you can hear from her how that all got started.
Good morning. So I've spent a good portion of the last week going through pictures from the last 12 years of ministry in Haiti, many of which you'll see behind us on the screens. It was a much needed visual of God's faithfulness to see the school as it was in 2011 when I saw the first pictures from my husband's first trip to Haiti until now. In a difficult week, it was a perfect reminder that this is and always has been a work of God. Going back in time to January 2010, I have a vivid memory of my oldest son and I sitting on the couch with the computer in our laps, watching footage of the devastating earthquake in Haiti. We watched in silence and with tears until Jason said, "I wish I could go there and play with those kids and make them smile." Since traveling to Haiti was not an option at that point, he decided to collect money to send there instead. After placing change collection jars at various businesses around the county, he had collected $235. Later, we learned that we were not the only ones to be stirred by the heartbreaking images of the earthquake. Our founding pastor, Dale Barrett, was also feeling a call to Haiti. He made a trip there in which he connected with Pastor Gilbert Jules, and they formed a ministry to train Haitian pastors in theology. Then in late 2010, a team from Grace traveled to Haiti on a multi-purpose mission trip, training pastors, teaching VBS, and doing various building projects. Jason sent his $235 with the team with instructions to use it to help kids in some way. While leading VBS in the village of Carrefour, they learned that there was a small culvert in front of the school that would overflow during the rainy season, making it hard for kids to get in. It was decided to use Jason's money to build a bridge so that the village children could get to school unhindered. While this was going on, I was also feeling a stirring in my heart to ministry to Haiti. I had long admired Kay Fox, who helps run Hand Clasp, a child sponsorship program in Thailand. We were also being challenged in a book study of David Platt's book, Radical, to live out our faith. These things combined in my heart and mind until they became the wild idea of starting a sponsorship program in Haiti. In the summer of 2011, we were camping with a few other families from Grace when I had one of those moments that felt so clearly like God was moving that it left me speechless. Over coffee at a picnic table one morning, Pastor Dale mentioned that Pastor Gilbert was praying for someone to begin a child sponsorship program to support one of his schools that was struggling. I think Jeremy was the first to respond by saying that I had been praying about that very thing. Before I knew it, I was in contact with Pastor Gilbert and then with Claudel soon after. Claudel and I, with the support from Gilbert and my friend Debbie Schnabel, worked together to form the Bridge Sponsorship Program, named after the little bridge that built with my son Jason's fundraising. To this day, I'm still blown away that I have the privilege of participating in what God is doing in Haiti. I'm incredibly thankful for all the support we've received here at Grace, from our church leadership, from our finance board, and from every one of our sponsors. What a gift it is to be a part of the body of Christ. Not just here at Grace, but across the world. We bear one another's burdens, carry each other when we're weak. We care, we love, we give of our resources to those in need. I hope this morning gives you a good idea of how your generosity has helped give life to the children of Carfapois.
I don't know how many of you really knew this, the beginning of that story, but there's over through the years, sometimes I remind Wendy when, you know, because, you know, running a ministry and a mission, there's challenges and sometimes there's discouragement. I'll remind her, you know, this is God's mission. God started this, and you heard a part of just how God brought all this together. And, you know, it's just reminding me that This is the Lord's work that we're participating, even with the Bridge Sponsorship Program. But as Wendy mentioned, part of that, of God bringing people together, is that he led her to Claudel here. Yeah. This is Claudel, my brother Claudel from Haiti. And so we're going to be hearing a bit, quite a bit from Claudel this morning to talk about the program and the sponsorship and the school and what's going on down there. Claudel was in the village living there at the time that we started this program, and he has now since moved to Florida, where he has been an instrumental help in, as a liaison between us and the school down there. And as I mentioned in the 9 a.m., he just speaks Creole a little better than her and I, so it's good to have him to help communicate, but he is huge, huge help. And so this morning, I just right now want to ask one question, and then we're gonna have a break and come back. But the first question I want to ask you, Claudel, is how the bridge began and how. Oh, I'm at the wrong question. My bad.
You're asking.
Yep. Oh my God, that was Wendy's part. Can you please share with us kind of a day in the life of a student there in Haiti, and including kind of your experience when you were living there, of what life is like?
Good morning, everyone. I am so happy to be here. I am so excited to get the privilege to share with you what you guys been doing in Haiti. And as Jamie said, my name is Claudel Romulus, and I'm born and raised in Carfapois, Haiti. A day in the life in Haiti for a child like me, I mean, when I was a child, it's a very rough life. I was in a broken family. I did not have a mom and dad that, you know, there for me to guide me, teach me any, you know, it teach me life. So basically, I was by myself. That's the situation for most of our kids in the village. Waking up in the morning, get ready. If you have a chance to enroll in school, you go to school and not even thinking about having breakfast or anything like that. You just wake up and get ready to go to school. You go to school, most of our school, 99% of our school don't offer any meals. So you, as a kid, you spend the whole day at the school trying to learn in a hungry stomach. Hungry, but try to learn. That was the situation, and for myself, and for most of our kids. And at some point, I got the privilege to participate in a summer program at the local church. You can see out there, that was my house. That's the whole house. It's just a room. And we don't have a place to, like a table to eat. We don't have a bathroom or anything. that's you cannot understand that. It's very crazy to explain that to you, but that's the reality. We where most of the time, where the water that we use for drinking water, that the water that we use to drink, we take it from the canal. That's where sometimes people, we wash our clothes in this canal. We use it for everything. And as far as her education, most of us don't have a chance to go to school because, the kids, we don't have the parents to enroll all in school. And what we do, the kids are, looking for a place to eat. And most of our environment, we had a Kafupa is a small village, but we have about 7 temples, voodoo temple, in that village. Most of the kids, go to those temples, and they use them to go they send them to do anything that they need to do, send them to a cemetery to get a body, dead body. And send them to go get alcohol. Here in America, it's illegal for a kid to go buy alcohol, but in Haiti, it's okay. So we get alcohol for them, and so we are most of the time we are on the voodoo temples to do the work, including myself. I used to do that when I was a kid, and they send me, and sometimes they give you a little bit of money, and you use that money to buy what you need. So that's that's most of our situation as kids in Kafupua in the village, and also. The most important thing is when we get the privilege to get to go to school, we play as a kid, and get back. We sometimes spend days without food. So it's very, very hard life. It's a tough life as a child in that village. And. Yeah, you can see some situation on the street where we got a small village, and the most important thing for us having the chance to know about God. After we know about God, even though I was still hungry and in need, and got a chance to teach those kids, guide them, and you can saw me in the. We see a picture while I'm serving those kids food, but you can see that guy is hungry. The guy that is offering the food, we see a picture. That was me serving kids when we got the privilege to serve them with food, but I'm hungry, but I'm happy because I know how much hungry they are. So basically that's when I'm very excited, when I know about the bridge and we know that we got some people in America, in church, that care for us, that would like to implement a program to help us as kids.
Thank you, Claudel.
Thank you.
So, yeah, it's it is a very challenging life in Haiti for these kids, and the bridge does offer the school there, gives them an opportunity to come and get them out of those situations and actually give them a meal every day. So we're going to hear more from Claudel in a little bit. But for right now, I think we're going to shift to Sheila. Here's going to give some announcements. All right, we'll be back.
Thank you for sharing. It's so good to be reminded of how the bridge came about. At this time, children, you are dismissed, and we will take a couple minutes to greet one another. Well, good morning and welcome. This is an exciting Sunday. Every Sunday is exciting, but we're really exciting today. If you are new here, you're here during our missions conference. So we have a different flow to our service, but we're so grateful to have you here. In the back of your chair, there is a white card. So if you're new here, we would love to get connected with you. If you want to fill that out and bring it to the Welcome Center, in the left as you leave here, there's someone waiting to chat with you, and a gift awaits you, and just to, if you have questions about the church, just to make a connection. So if you don't mind doing that, we would love that. Missions Conference continues next weekend. So just so you know, what we're starting this week is continuing next week, and including after church, the Missions Board is providing us with lunch. So if you're able to stay after church next Sunday, lunch is provided, and it's a great time to fellowship and continue our exploring what is going on missions-wise here at our church. So, and just a reminder, if you're not aware of this, every Wednesday here at the church at 6:15 in the library, there's a prayer meeting. So it's a time you can come and join with others from our church to be praying, and I think to be prayed for also. So that's just a reminder, library, 6:15 on Wednesdays, every Wednesday. There is a new newsletter out. That's kind of a weird. There's what would be another way to say that? A new edition? No, I put a word in. A new edition of the newsletter is out. It's on the right as you leave here. But I do want to just point out, there is a daycare update in here. So if a few weeks ago the daycare was kind of new that you were learning about that, there is more information on what is happening on that, and plus a lot of other wonderful information in here. So, but if you have questions on that, great place to pick that up and learn some more. Right after church today, I know this has been announced, but we are meeting. It's in the library, I believe, Sierra, is that right? For youth. If anyone is interested in helping with the youth, Matthew and I will be there, Sierra will be there, and want to sit down and chat. I think Pastor Mark will be there also. And just to kind of learn, we'd love parents to be there to learn kind of what your thoughts and desires are for the youth here at Grace and how we can join with you on that. So that will be following right after church. And then the last announcement, there are three ways to give here. I was going to say four again. That's in my mind from last week, apparently. But there's three ways to give here at Grace. There's a box in the back before and after the service. There is a Vanco app that you can send your money in, or you can mail it in. And just thank you for continuing to give. As we already talked about, the money that's given, there's money directly taken out of that goes to missions and other wonderful, but since it's missions weekend, you know, money goes directly to that. So thank you for just continuing to give. And would you just join me in praying? Lord, thank you just for this day, another day of life, and just your presence here, and for every person that's here, Lord. What a gift is just to gather together, and really so encouraging, and just a reminder of the work that is happening outside of here, Lord, that even through the money that we give helps with that, but it's so good just to be aware of even Wendy telling her story about how you put it on her heart to move forward with this bridge, and on Jason just to raise money and different. I'm just so excited for what else is coming today and the rest of this missions conference weekends, this weekend and next weekend. So just thank you, Lord, for how you continue to move here and in other places, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. We're going to go ahead and continue on with our worship this morning, but you can feel free to stand or you can sit during this one. This is a very particular song regarding the need that is apparent, especially for times like this. And it's our hope that that need catches fire within our souls, each one of us, to recognize that there are people that really, really need help. With that, all the poor and powerless.
And all the poor and powerless, and all the lost and lonely, come confess. I know that you are holy. I know that you are holy.
Father God, just as Jesus commanded, go now and preach to the Gentiles, every nation. We just we stand in awe today of the power so many years later is still working through our hands. But like Jeremy kept repeating, it's your mission. You want everyone to hear the gospel. I just prayed today and the following, the next week, and as missionaries are coming and going and we're hearing stories, we just pray that the Holy Spirit envelops and safely provides travel, and that the Lord can really speak through the people to touch hearts, to help us engage in your church, which is way beyond what's inside of our doors here in Amador County. And we just ask a blessing on the speakers this weekend and next weekend. And in your son Jesus' name, we pray all this. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
Hello, we're back. So I want to continue to ask Clael some questions so you can hear more about what's going on in Haiti and with the bridge. So, Claudel, I'd like to ask, how has the bridge helped the school and students in Carrefourpois, Haiti?
Yes, the bridge is helping in so different ways. And one of the ways that the bridge is helping is, helping to build more classrooms for the students so we can have expand the school. And the school, before the bridge, the school was only up to sixth grade, from, first grade to sixth grade. And because of, donations from the bridge, from Christ Fellowship and through the bridge, we got the privilege to add more classrooms. I remember in 2015, when I came here and the mission donated money to the bridge, and the bridge sent that money to Haiti. And we use that money to build three classrooms, the seventh grade, eighth grade, and ninth grade. So that was really helpful. That's one of the ways that the bridge is helping. And other way that we're helping is playground equipment. So, as an important, as you all know, that it's very important for the kids to play. They say that one of the jobs of the kids is play. When kids do, when they're playing, like they're working. So having the privilege to put a basketball hoop at the school, I don't remember the date. Basketball hoop at the school so the kids can play, and that was a really helpful. Other way that we're helping is food. Food is, I always say that it's one of the most important thing for us in Carrefourpois, because I go to school with an empty stomach, it's very difficult to learn. It's difficult to learn when you're hungry. And our kids in Carrefourpois and our community in Carrefourpois is a hungry community. We don't have enough to feed our kids. And kids spending days and without having to eat. So because of the bridge, every single day we have school there, the kids, they don't have to worry about food. They know for sure they're going to have a lunch at the school, which is extremely important for us. You can see it's a lot of food in front of one child, but it's not, we eat once for the day. We're not going to have anything when we get home. We have to fill the belly as much as we can, because, that's all for the day. And even on the weekend, we don't have that opportunity to eat. Some kids spend the whole weekend without eating, but hopefully on Monday, they're going to go to school. And because of the bridge, because of the mission board always send donation to us, and we use that donation to get food for our needing kids. Other way that we're helping is get them the chance to know God. So we're teaching those kids, not only teaching them to love the country and to do good for the country, which is extremely important, but also to know that God loves them, to know the good news about about God, and to know that we have for the people in the world that care for them, for the people that knows God and they know and just sharing the love of God to us, which is extremely important for us to know and know about God. And, you know, because we know when they know about God, so many things, people can't use them for, you know, to go on the gangs, to be a gangs member, or to kill, or to do voodoo. Even though some of our kids, when they learn about God and they want to accept God, because we have the parents not believers, they can't go to Christ. It's difficult for them. Some of them, the parents, you know, stop them from accepting God, stop them from going to church, stop them from baptized. Some of them, they give them the privilege to, you can go to church, but you can't be baptized because you still, if you're baptized, you're not going to be able to come back to my house. So that's the situation. But hopefully, you know, God can touch those people's life and those parents. They can come to God and, you know, live, you know, God's words. So.
My name is Julian James Lee. I have been in this program for 8 years. This program helps me so much. I hear the gospel about this program. I accepted Jesus in my life. I play drum in my church. I bless the name of God because he gives me the chance to take part in this program. Thank you so much.
That's a typical example of our kids. He's been in the program since the beginning, and now he's in ninth grade. And also he becomes a Christian. He plays drums at the church. So that's a big example. That's a privilege for us in knowing that those kids could be anything, could be on the street with guns and killing people, you know, can become a, could be a voodoo preacher. But now because of your support, because of your prayers and all those, you know, financial support, these kids got to go to school and got to know God. That's a privilege. And we're so grateful for that. And also, not only are we helping our teachers to become, you know, better teacher, to teach our kids through a program they call P4H. We can see all of that, those are our teachers. And grace again, help the bridge and, help us financially so we can help those our teachers to get a better training and so they can train our kids better. All that's become from you guys. You give the all support so we can have a better education in the village. And we're so grateful for that. And other way, we got vocational training for our kids. We got sewing, we got jewelry. You can see them on the table behind. We got our kids that, you know, learn how to, you know, in Haiti is different than here. We have to get a uniform to go to school. Hey, I don't think you need a uniform to go to schools, except some school, but in Haiti, you need a uniform. But now we got some kids, some of our students learning how to, you know, do it themselves. And we got donation from the bridge to have those equipment ready so the kids can learn and be, you know, do it themselves for the school, which we are so grateful for that again. And Grace Fellowship been helping in so many different ways, from training our staff and get a better education, from feeding us, the food every single day that we have class. So we're just grateful. We're just grateful for everything that the bridge have been doing for us.
Thank you. You know, Claudel mentioned the table in the back. We do have one for the bridge, and we just encourage you after church today, and it's Pastor Mark mentioned they'll be back there for a couple more weeks, but just go check it out. There's information on how you can sponsor a child if you're not doing so, or if you want to take on another one if you are a sponsor, but there's information back there about that, as well as there are some items of jewelry and that the kids have made to help raise money. That so you can go look at that, and they're available for purchase to help raise money. So this question is going to go to both of you, but what are some current challenges with the Bridge program, and how can we work towards improving things more?
Real quick before I answer the question, there's a lot of pictures up here of the village of Carverpaw and the school and just how poverty-stricken and just difficult circumstances there are. But I also want to point out that the slides behind the lyrics this week are all taken in Haiti. There is beauty in Haiti. It is a beautiful country. And there's a lot of devastation also, but God is good and he has beauty everywhere we look. So to answer the question, communication and getting accurate and updated records in a timely manner has been an ongoing struggle. I'm excited that Claudel's wife, Lainey, has offered to help work with the school to teach them more effective organizational structures that will benefit both the school and the Bridge moving forward. And I'm very excited to have Lainey on our team. Secondly, the need in Haiti is so great that sometimes it's hard to know how to prioritize our resources. The original intent of the Bridge was that our donations would primarily support the neediest students in the village, and by paying their tuition, we would also be supporting the school. What I didn't realize at the time was that the school hadn't been able to pay its teachers for some time and was at risk of closing down. So due to the immediate needs, our funds ended up covering the school's payroll and helping our sponsored students more as a secondary function. This structure has enabled our donations to impact all 300 students plus the teachers, which has been wonderful. But moving forward, we hope to help the school gain greater sustainability on its own, while also growing in our ability to impact our individual sponsored students with both physical and spiritual needs. And now Claudel is going to share a project that he's been working on in order to support our students better.
Thank you. You can see those pictures, this little girl. I can tell you she got a baby. You know why she got a baby? Because somebody offered her, she's hungry, and they offer her a plate of food, and this guy have, you know, relationship with her, and now she got a baby without a dad. Why? Because she didn't have a family. She didn't have somebody to care for her. And, you know, she's a girl, and, you know, they abuse her and give her, you know, plate of food. Now she got a kid. You can see a couple pictures of those kids that they belong on the bridge, but even though they're on the bridge, they eat at the school. But after the school, they still need to eat, you know, in the afternoon. They still need to eat in the weekend. And guys offer them things to eat, and they abuse them. Couple kids like that on the bridge getting kids while they're hungry. Because they're hungry, they got a kid to take care of. So the situation become worse and worse. And for me, as someone who lived through the situation, who understand the situation better than anybody here, and I was blown away when I know what happened, and when I noticed that, you know, all of my kids and need a place to stay. What I decided to do, me and my wife, we decided to, you know, take, you know, from our budget and always keep, you know, some money away so we can use to build a home so we can have some family. That's the house that we're building in Haiti so we can have, you know, a couple kids that really, the needy one, the one that need the most, we can have, they can have a place to stay. We can, you know, give them guidance. We can give them, you know, better education and give them, you know, a place to, you know, even our girls in Haiti, if you think about the girls who doesn't have a place to, you know, doesn't have a restroom at their house, they don't have a bathroom. So they have to go to the, you know, to the gardens or to the river to use, you know, has to get to have, you know, to take care, to do physiology things. That's just crazy. That's the way it is in my village. So having, building that house that we started to build a house and hopefully God provide, we finish it. Those, we can have a couple of kids, 20 to 50 kids. We call it children home. So we can have as many as we're capable of. So those kids gonna be able to know that, you know, they got, we can have, you know, people to guide them, even though we're going to pay them, but we pay them to guide them and they can have education. They can have, you know, any kids our bridge can come over for dinner. They can come over for, you know, to play and spend the day there. And even those that need the most can stay, but those that got a place to stay, they can still stay at their house. But they know they got a place to come for help that they need. That's the goal. That's what we're working on. And that, I think that's going to be a good help for the village.
Well, that was something that God laid on Claudel's heart to do, to help the school and help the village, on his own. And I will tell you guys, you know, it's been a privilege that we get to work so closely with Claudel. But I can't emphasize enough how much of a heart of love and devotion this man has for his people in Haiti and in Carrefourpois. It's phenomenal. There's a lot we can learn from that. And that love for others. Claudel, thank you for that. I think my last question is, can you tell us more about some of the specific needs the school in Carrefourpois is currently facing, and picking on the food and water situation?
Thank you. Before I go to that question, I'm gonna tell you, those guys had a reason that, you know, I got more involved in those kids' life, because they show love for us, even though, you know, they're 300 miles away from us in Haiti. I mean, 3,000, I don't remember. 3,000 miles away from us in Haiti. And they love us so much, so deeply. And they share it. They want the best for us. They want us to, you know, to know God and to have education. I said, what about me? I live to that situation. I know that situation better than them. And they care for me like that. So I have to do something. As a Christian, know God, you know, because of the love of God, they do all of that for me. I gotta do something. I have to do something. And I'm really grateful for you guys. And so it's an honor for me to get to know you and to see the love you have for God and for the people of Haiti, for me. I can't imagine how much you love me and how much you care for us. And Wendy want the best for our kid, not even her kid. They're not her kid, but you know, she considers all those kids in the bridge as her kid. She loved for them the same way she cared for her own kid. And I'm really grateful to get to know you and see how much you love us, and that, you know, blow away my heart and make me understand the situation better and want to help any way that I can. And our current situation is that Grace through Bridge give us pay for us to have a to have water in the village. We have a well. Thank you. We have a well in the church, at the church, so the kids can use, and the people in the village can come whenever they need water, because we don't have water in the village. So Grace help us that way. But now we have a situation where, you know, for some reasons, the well is dry. We can't get water from that well no more. So what happened is, that's the world. And my people, we go get water from the canal. And what we do in the canal, that's where we get, you know, the people, we wash our clothes in it. People take a shower on it. That's the water, that's one of our kids taking water, that's our staff taking water from the canal and to make food. So, and it's a very, you know, very difficult situation. And when I find out about the price, and we will need about $7,000 just to dig, you know, the well for the kids and for all the village, because not only the kids get water from there, all the village get water from that well. And that's one of the need that we have. And the other need, we have a lot of need, but too much of need, the other one is about the food. We haven't get a chance to get food for the school. As I explained that to you all, it's the food is we really need food, and we don't have enough. We don't have food for the school, and when we find out that to have food for the rest of the year, we will need another $3,000 for to have food for the kids. So those are two major needs that we have right now in the village.
So I'm sure, I mean, we're experiencing inflation here, but in Haiti, it is absolutely astronomical, the cost of the food situation. And it's been a challenge significantly. What is happening is there is a container, shipping container of food that's in the port in Port-au-Prince, right? And it's got hung up there. Okay.
We have some reserved.
Okay. So we are getting a portion of a shipping container of food, and that portion for the school is $3,000, is going to cost $3,000 to get it to the school, and the cost of the food. The it's going to be enough food just to cover at least till the end of this school year. So there's definitely a need for the ability to get the food into the school. As you guys heard, the criticality of being able to provide a meal to these kids. And as far as the well goes, we have actually received already $3,000 towards the well that's been designated, which we greatly appreciate. And so as next weekend, there is going to be more information provided about how you can potentially, you know, give specifically to these needs if you would like. Some more information coming next week. But I just want to thank you, Claudel, for coming and for sharing with everybody here. Give us more information and detail about what goes on in the school and just the great impact that all of you have who support this school. It is a significant impact. I've often said before, I wish all our sponsors could go down to Haiti and see these kids and just see, you know, what your giving is doing for these kids' lives. We just thank you for your faithful support. So thank you, Claudel. We have one last video message that is from the school to the church as a blessing, so we'll play that this time.
God bless you.
The need is great, church. There's one thing that Claudel said that struck me. He said that, you know, he knows the situation far, far greater than even Jeremy and Wendy. People that have actually been there and seen it with their own eyes. He's been part of that. He's lived it. He's grown up in that whole situation. And that need that is there has been so prevalent. And there's hardly any way to fix or adjust or move except through God's help and through people like you. The urgency is great, from the urgency for knowing God for our families, for our individual homes, for our children, to their children. So I'm going to challenge you with this song to use it as a prayer. That everybody in this place and in that place and all over the world for need are blessed.
thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May His presence go before you, and behind you, and beside you, all around you, and within you. He is with you, He is with you. In the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing, He is for you, He is for you.
To take in, isn't it?
Yeah. On the one side, these are all ministries and missions that we are already a part of. We are doing the work. We have been doing the work to enable the blessing of Jesus and the meeting of very common needs to be met in Haiti. I'm so grateful to have partnered with The Bridge and with Gilbert and Claudel and the school in Carrefour. But as you can imagine, the need goes beyond even what we are doing. And it's easy to become overwhelmed by that. And so I think in part the prayer of our missions board, as they were praying and seeking how to, what specifically God would have for us to hear from Him, and what are we supposed to act on, and so on. And that's really what was born out of this theme, give that they may live. And the theme verse specifically, just reading it again, Let them do good, that they may be rich in good works, ready to give, willing to share. There is nothing more important than having faith in Jesus Christ, because through our faith in Jesus Christ, we have a relationship with the eternal God who has spoken our existence into being. But beyond that, we have a daily need to have basic sustenance for our stomachs, right? James adds to this idea that faith in Jesus is absolutely essential. But faith without some follow-up of what faith might produce, the good works of putting a meal in someone's stomach who has a need, what good is the faith? And so we are so grateful that we lead the charge with faith in Jesus, but along with that, we recognize that we want to supply education. We want to put a meal in a child's stomach. And I love this idea, Claudel, that you are putting. I think I see those walls going up for a children's center. And it spoke more than just a place for them to live, but it's really almost a safe haven, a rock of refuge. So if they're not out on the weekend trying to fend for themselves and being subject to predators and abusers that further their despair in this world just because they have hunger. And so I just want to follow up with this. Is the heart of us is that I want two messages. One, we are in the fight. We are providing and doing the things that this verse compels us to do, that the very scriptures do, that we're acting on the very faith that we enjoy in Jesus. But as you can imagine, there's always more need. And if you feel compelled to do something beyond what we are doing, there's going to be opportunities for that. Next Sunday in particular, we're going to take a special offering that will benefit both Claudel and the missionaries you've heard from today, as well as the missionaries we're going to hear from next week, the Hobsons from Uganda, as well as the Ankars who are ministering among the Navajo Nation. And as you also have understood, there's needs beyond, very specific needs to drill a new well. Clean water is something we take for granted. That is absolutely a necessity for the health and well-being of people. And so we're going to be launching a project that will continue and, God willing, be able to complete the funding for that well to be put in place, for that container of food to make sure that it gets to the students at the school. And so you'll be hearing more about that next Sunday as well. And so I want to, as we draw our service to a close today, I just want to draw attention to one more thing, and then we're going to close in prayer. And that is, when you look out to your right this morning, there's a number of stations, prayer stations that have been set up. And in addition to our desire for you to visit our missionary tables and so on, the prayer stations are going to be not just available this morning before and after service, next Sunday before and after, and also in 2 weeks, they are going to be open during our regular office hours as well. 9 to 4, Monday through Thursday, you can come and as you look over and see, kind of get a view of what, how you can participate in. They're very interactive. They're very participatory. Some of them have something to take away, to keep a keepsake for when you take home, to remind you about a particular prayer request and so on. They're really well done. I want to invite you to visit these over the next 3 weeks as well. And so, just grateful for all of the presentations this morning. And before I read their final verse as a blessing to send us out, I want to draw to your attention to one thing. One of our own, Gary Humphrey, who is Gary and Janet have been a long part of our church here, our fellowship, very involved. Janet is on the board with New Hope Home. Gary is going to be undergoing bypass surgery on Tuesday. If you know Gary, you know he's very active, hiker, loves the outdoors. So this is kind of an out-of-the-blue shock that he went to the doctor and they found that he had 100% blockage, a 90%, an 80% blockage, and they're in kind of a place where a stent does not help. They need to go in and do some repairs. And so, as you can imagine, that's kind of a difficult thing to wrap your mind around in a moment. And so we want to be praying for Gary and Janet. Both their boys are with them. He's at a hospital in Modesto, and their surgeon is a very reputable surgeon, and so we're praying for them very specifically. So will you join me as we finish our service in prayer? Father, we are so grateful for your love for us. These needs, God, are some of them are quite new to us, and they feel very overwhelming. God, these needs have long been known by you, and you've already prompted things to be in place to meet the very needs of your children, whom you deeply care for, their ongoing needs throughout the day, whether or not they're going to have clean water, whether or not they're going to have a meal, whether or not they're going to be protected from predators, abusers, gang violence, and so on. God, you care for your children. You sent your son to die that we might live. Thank you for your love. Help us to know what our role might be in extending your love in very practical ways with the news of your son, Jesus Christ. And we pray this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like to read one passage. If you just stand together as we conclude our service, I'm going to read the passage in Numbers chapter 6 that the worship team just led us out with in that song entitled The Blessing. This is found in Numbers 6, verses 24 through 26. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Go, grace and peace to you today.